First flow solution is a Couette flow, or a surface-driven flow. And so we want to imagine two infinite parallel plates. We want to imagine flow moving in the x direction. I've listed the coordinate frame here. So I'm assuming that these plates are separated by a distance in the y direction, and I have flow moving only in the x direction. We have complete symmetry in the z direction, so I won't be considering any derivatives in that direction. And again, normally, people talk about these flows in the context of two different walls physically moving against each other, but we're going to be interested in this because of the way it's going to come out of electrokinetically driven flow. Now, I can write the Navier-Stokes equations for this flow. And I should probably take a moment to tell you a few things about my notation. You can see here that I'm using this symbol, whatever you want to call it, which is supposed to be rho, and this is density. And you can contrast with this symbol over here, which is supposed to be a p. And this is pressure. If you're ever in doubt between the difference between the two, if there's a little tail on it, that means I'm trying to draw a p. If there's no tail on it, that means that I'm trying to draw a row. We'll use eta to denote the viscosity. Now, in most mechanical engineering contexts, people use mu to denote the viscosity, and of course, there's nothing wrong with that. However, in electrokinetic transport, we have lots and lots of different parameters known as mobilities, and these mobilities are typically described in terms of the Greek letter mu. So I want to reserve mu for these mobilities, and I'll use this eta for viscosity. And this eta notation happens to be more common in chemical engineering, for what it's worth. Now, this equation can be simplified significantly because of the geometry I've chosen. I've said that I have plates that are parallel. I've said that they're infinite at extent. I've said that the flow is only in the x direction. I can furthermore add to this that there's no pressure gradient. And when I do that, I basically make most of the terms in this governing equation go away. So I've assumed that this flow is steady. That allows me to cancel out this unsteady term. I said that there's no pressure gradient, which allows me to cancel this pressure term. And now all I'm left with is the convective flux of momentum and the net volumetric viscous force. Now, because I've assumed that this flow is unidirectional, I can also neglect this convective term. So here I'm taking the dot product of two different tensors. I have the velocity, which is a vector or a rank 1 tensor. And I have the velocity gradient tensor here, grad u, which is a second order tensor. These two tensors are orthogonal, meaning that when I take their dot product, I get 0. And so this can be neglected. Now, the reason why these are orthogonal is basically because I've specified that the flow is unidirectional. And in this context, what that means is that if I look at this velocity vector u, which I would normally write with components u, v, and w, the only component of that that's non-zero is the component in the x direction. That was a constraint of the problem. Furthermore, I said that these plates were infinite in extent, so they extend infinitely in the x direction and they extend infinitely in the z direction. And so this gradient only has terms in the y direction. So I have velocity in the x direction. I have gradients in the y direction. And when I take the dot products of those two things, they're orthogonal. When I take this dot product of these orthogonal vectors, for example, if I take u dotted by the gradient of v, the gradient of u gradient of V, and gradient of W. Each of these components ends up being a dot product of orthogonal vectors, and I end up getting 0. So the net effect of things is that I have a very complicated equation, partial differential equations. I have a nonlinear term. But if I specify away enough of the variation, if I say the pressure isn't changing, if I say it's steady, and if I say it's unidirectional, now I can eliminate basically all of these terms. What I'm left with then is this expression. I had 4 terms. I said 3 of them were equal to 0, which means that the fourth one has to be 0 as well. And this now is the governing equation for a Couette flow. Now, as I've written this, it's a vector equation. But again, I can simplify this because I placed a whole bunch of constraints on the problem. I said that u was a vector, but it only had a component in the x direction. So I really don't need to write 3 different scalar equations. I only need one. The one I'm trying to solve for is the x component of the velocity. Furthermore, I'm taking a vector Laplacian, but I've already said that there's no variation in the x direction and there's no variation in the z direction. So all I need to do is keep the x component of the velocity, and all I need to do is keep the y aspect of this Laplacian. So if I write this in a 1D form, this now takes this form. And this equation, even though I've written it with partial derivatives, is effectively an ordinary differential equation that I can integrate twice. And what this integration tells me is that this velocity is basically given by a linear distribution. Now, in my original form of this depiction, I said that there was a surface-driven flow, but I actually never specified what the boundary conditions are. So let's do that now. I'm going to say, in general, that this top wall is moving with a velocity that I'll call u sub h. And I'll say that this bottom wall is moving with a velocity u sub l. And I'll say that these two infinite walls are located at y is equal to h and y is equal to minus h. When I do this, I now have the two boundary conditions that are required for me to specify these two constants. If I say that u at y is equal to h is equal to u sub h, and u at y is equal to minus h is equal to u sub l, I can then solve for these constants.